Thank you, Jesus. I want to present to you today this woman of God, amen, has been a great blessing to me. I loved her because when I met her, she had a sincere heart. But what impressed me about her was that she had an unusual anointing. And most people that God has anointed with an unusual anointing, people don't understand.
Amen.
More often they misunderstand and they misjudge. Amen. But I saw her heart and I knew her battle because of the anointing that is on her life. I saw the witches as they tried to gather. Tried to gather around this woman of God, and God gave me intercession for this woman of God. I want you to be blessed by Pastor DeWanda Major Chancellor. She's the pastor of Temple of Truth Ministries in Harvey, Louisiana. And I just want you to be blessed. I want you to open your mind and your heart to receive the woman of God. Stand up on your feet and bless her. Amen.
Amen.
Song ministers to her as she prepares. Amen. Amen. Glory be to God. You may have your seat. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise Him now.
Thank you, Jesus.
And praise Him again, yeah. Praise Him every time you get a chance. He's the source of your favor. Let me thank Him each year the more. Fruit of the man.
Glory be to God. Hallelujah.
It
is truly an honor to be standing before you here today. Hallelujah. I give God the praise. Give Him the honor and I give Him the glory for my life and for the things that He has done in my life. The woman of God is such a so true introduction. A lot of times people don't catch that. That I have an unusual anointing. And because I was birthed with the anointing of boldness for the Word of God, sometimes people are standoffish and they stand back, not knowing that that's just the anointing on my life. I tell people I'm really a humble person. But then my husband looks sideways, but I'm a humble person. So I give God the glory this morning. I am Pastor DeWanda Chancellor. I am glad to be here representing the Temple of Truth Ministry with maybe a couple of our members who give God. It's a blessing when people follow you and support you. I don't count it lightly. If you're here from Temple of Truth, would you please stand? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. I tell people all the time, the Lord didn't tell me I would have a, you may be seated, ladies, I thank you for coming. The Lord didn't tell me I would have a lot of members, but He said that I would do great work.
All right.
A lot of times people get that confused. Yeah. You don't have to have a lot of members
to do great
work.
Right.
You don't have to be on TV to be a great worker of the gospel.
That's right.
Hallelujah. A lot of times the greatest gospel that's going forth is in the kitchen.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
I know some of my best hymns that were sung to me in my ear was when I was in the kitchen and my grandmother was pressing my hair.
Yes.
She would hum an old spiritual that say, how I got over.
Yes.
My soul looks back in wonder.
Wow.
How I got over.
Yes.
So I give God the glory for my upbringing. I give God the glory for my anointing. I give God the glory for the woman of God for the invite. And I thank you for your undivided attention today.
Amen.
She challenged me with a topic of prayer and intercession. And I found it quite interesting that for her to give me that topic, because that is my calling.
All right.
Praying and interceding for others. If you have your Bibles, if you would turn with me to the book of Acts, chapter 16, verse 25. Verse 25 reads, "And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God. And the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundation of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bands were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awakening out of his sleep, and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, Do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Then he called for a light and sprang and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, Sirs, what must I do to be saved? You must be seated, and you may be seated in the presence of God. We know that the Lord, the word of the Lord is already blessed. We have a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of it. Hallelujah. Father God, in the mighty name of Jesus, as I stand before your people today, Father God, let them see and hear you and not me, Father God. Let the anointing that you have on my life, Father God, rest, rule, and abide at this present time, Father God, so that the people will be able to run out of here to say, what must I do to be saved? What a mighty God we serve. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. If I had to put a topic to this message today, it would be, everybody needs a midnight. Sometimes we get caught up in the daytime that we forget about things happen at midnight. And when we think about prayer, I said, Lord, what is prayer? And I looked up the meaning of prayer, and the Webster Dictionary said prayer is a devout petition to God. You know, in worship. A lot of times we get it confused. We think that we're worshiping God and we're not praying to him. I'm here to serve the notice on the church that you can't worship him and not pray to him. You can't worship him and not commune with him. You can't say you know him and he doesn't know you. You conversate with the people that you know. That's how they get, you get an intimate relationship. I tell people, you tell everybody want to say they know God, but you don't ever talk to him. You don't never call him up. Hallelujah. As a matter of fact, when you find yourself in need, you'll call a friend and ask them to call on the name of Jesus. Rather than you using your keys. Everybody may not know it, but prayer is the key. Faith unlocks the door, but prayer is the key. And then I looked a little further and it says prayer is a spiritual communion with God. Or an object of worship, as in supplication, thanksgiving, adoration, and confession. So when we go into prayer, people of God, oh yeah, we're supposed to make supplication to him. Thanksgiving. Adoring him. Oh, you know, if we got spouses in our lives, we pat them on the back, tell them, oh, you look good. You did this for me. I you that and you this. Why don't we go to him and tell him, God, Lord, I adore you. You are kings of kings in my life. You've been my all in all. I remember when I was single before I got blessed with the husband that I have, people used to ask me, oh, are you going to ever get you a husband? I used to tell them, I got a lover named Jesus, and he supplies my every need. And I could feel the anointing coming on my life when I would say that, because he loves to hear about him. Hallelujah. He's an arrogant God. He loves to hear about himself. In other words, he says, pat me on the back. Hallelujah. And then it says that the act or practice of praying to God or an object of worship is a formula in order to get things to happen and move around in your life. Hallelujah. If you want results in your life, you had better get a prayer life. A prayer life. A prayer life.
A prayer life.
Yes.
A prayer life brings about a change.
Yes.
A prayer life brings about praise and worship. I tell people all the time, you want to get to church just for the word, but you miss the good part.
Yes. Yes.
You miss the good part. If you come out to praise and worship, you come out that we have did intercessory prayer, yes, you don't miss the good part because that sets the tone, yes, for what's about to happen. Further down in the text, you will find that Paul and Silas hung around for a while with these group of women. They would go back and forth every day.
Hallelujah.
And on one day, hallelujah, the woman had been traveling following Paul and Silas. And every time she would see them, she would tell everybody, these are men of the Most High God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. But she was full of an unclean spirit.
Yeah.
So I want to tell you, tell the church today that everybody say, that everybody that approaches you and say, hey, you holy woman of God. Or hey, you anointed woman of God. Hallelujah. Even though they speaking what is true,
right,
it doesn't mean that they are right in the right spirit.
Yeah.
This woman had an unclean spirit in her. But I do want to tell the church that who you are in Christ, even the unclean spirits got about to. Hallelujah. So she followed them every day. That's how much power in prayer. If you pray and you believe what you're praying about, now the devil in hell can stop your prayers. Hallelujah. So as he turned around, he finally got tired of her. The scripture says his spirit got vexed because she kept doing it. And so he just turned around and said, come out of her, you unclean spirit.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And immediately, she was set free.
Yes.
She was delivered.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So I, when I was reading the text, I said, Lord, have mercy. I said, Paul started with prayer with a group of women. A woman by the name of Lydia received the Holy Ghost, received deliverance. And then we had a damsel that was in what they called a slave girl. She was delivered out of slavery, and she was delivered from the demon. She was slaying slavery to her masters, but how many of y'all know when they found out they couldn't make no more money off of her, they released her. Hallelujah, she was delivered. She was set free. There's some people in here today, hallelujah, that are slaves to certain things. Hallelujah, but the Spirit of God says, come out of you, you unclean spirit. As of this day, you are delivered and set free. Hallelujah. So further on along in the text, after Paul did all of this, the men, how many of y'all know the men in the city got up, they got upset? Hallelujah. Because see, you was affecting their pocketbook. Hallelujah. Lord have mercy. That's what happens when you start doing the will of God, when prayer starts to work in your life. See, you may be like me. When I first started praying and got excited about God, I thought everybody was going to be with me.
That's right.
But people started dropping off.
That's
hallelujah.
Right.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes.
And so what the Spirit of the Lord told me, he said, oh, they dropping off, but you being set free.
Yeah.
You've been in bondage to them for a long time.
Yeah.
They've been using you for what they could get out of you anyway. But how about there? You are no longer theirs. You're only mine.
Yeah.
You're only going to serve me. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Sometimes we get so caught up into our jobs that we have so much money. We want to make this happen and make that happen. When all we need to do is yield to what God has for us to do. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Prayer is the key. Hallelujah. So after these men got upset with Paul and Silas, hallelujah, they beat them and threw them into prison. But what I love about the midnight, hallelujah, is that the scripture says, and at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. Now, when I used to hear this preached before I became a preacher myself, and the Holy Spirit started to deal with me, I used to hear the preacher say, at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed. One sang and one prayed. But the scripture says, at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed.
That's right.
So that brought me back to what two or three are gathered together
that's
in his name.
Right.
He'll be faithful to be a God in the midst. And then it reminded me that if I make my bed in hell, behold, he'll be there.
Right.
Hallelujah. He showed up in a locked jail cell.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Honoring the prayers of two righteous men. Honoring the prayers of two believers.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Do I have any believers in the house today? All I need is two.
Hallelujah.
It says, and at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed. They prayed and they sang praises unto God. And the prisoners heard them. I want you to know that when you start to pray to God and you start to praising him, somebody needs to hear your cry. Somebody needs to hear your voice. Somebody needs to be able to tap in to what you're doing. Hallelujah. 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 That's why he says, come boldly before the throne. I'm bold, y'all.
Yeah.
Not alone. I try to calm it down when I just a little.
Bold.
Hallelujah. But anyway, when I went to this scripture, I asked the Lord, I said, said, Lord Jesus, what do you want me to tell the church? He said, tell the church that everybody need a midnight. Because right before daylight, there's a midnight. You know how we love it. We love to meditate on the scripture. He says that joy comes in the morning. How about you need to be praying at midnight to be able to get that joy in the morning? Hallelujah. You need a midnight in your life, baby.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And then it says that, and the prisoners heard them. See, when I think about what that scripture means about the prisoners heard them, that means that the prisoners were introduced to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. There was a new sound in their ears. Hallelujah. They had a rumbling in their hearts. Hallelujah. And their hearts started to yearn for that anointing that Paul and Silas carried. See, a lot of us got a lot of weight in our voice, but no anointing. But the anointing destroys the yoke. I tell you right now, I'm a prayer warrior. If I can call on the name of Jesus, he'll come in and see about me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then the scripture number 26 said, and suddenly there was a great earthquake. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When we think about earthquakes, we're thinking about the foundation of the earth. Shaking, trembling. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They're in prison. Think about this.
That's right.
They're in prison.
Bound.
Locked up. They tell me that they put Paul and Silas in the inner court. That means that they wasn't where they could get out to the outside. There were some places on the inside. They put them on the inside of the inside of prison. Hallelujah. But an earthquake came around. A suddenly happened. See, when you start to pray and you start to worship it, and you believe in what you're praying and you're worshiping, there's a sound that'll come in your ear. And then you'll have a suddenly experience in your life. Everything with God happens suddenly. Hallelujah. You may not recognize it 2 days later, but it happens suddenly. It says a suddenly was there and a great earthquake. And then they said, for the foundation of the prison was shaken. And immediately, the doors, all the doors were open, and everyone's bands were loose. That means that prison doors were open, the shackles were set, chains were broken, everything. Hallelujah. All because they heard the name of Jesus. All because they heard the name of Jesus. I decree and declare today that there will be chains broken in your life. All because you heard the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh yeah, he gives us talent. He gives us the ability to lay hands. But there are some that are just don't even have to be in the room with you. They can speak a word. You can feel their anointing. And you're set free because of their presence. Hallelujah. And it says that, and the keeper of the prison, awakening out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Hallelujah. There are going to be some people, hallelujah, that have been paid, bought with a price, to keep you bound and shackled. Hallelujah. A lot of times, it's on your job. A lot of times, it's in your household. A lot of times, it's in your church. They've been paid to keep you bound and shackled. But there will be a great earthquake that will come around. And you're going to be the very one that have to pray for them and say, don't do yourself no harm. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost is here. Hallelujah. When the Holy Ghost come up on the scene, there's a transformation that happens. It says, but Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm. We're all here. Now, don't you think Paul, Silas, and all the prisoners could have been free, could have been gone?
Yeah.
But see, what the scripture wants us to get is that spiritually,
they were free. That's right.
Uh-huh.
That's right.
When you're spiritually free, you're free indeed. When you're spiritually free, you're free indeed. That's what's wrong with a lot of us. We focus so much on the physical and the natural things that's going on in life. Some of us need to get some spiritual freedom in our life. Get free to call on the name of Jesus. Get free to sing hymns to our Lord and Savior. Get free to speak to the wind and watch it obey you. Get free to say, get behind me, demon. You have no authority in my life. But when you speak it, you got to speak with authority. You got to speak with the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus has weight. Hallelujah. 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 My grandmother used to say, if I couldn't say a word, I would just wave my hand. And in my heart, I'd be saying, Jesus. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Then they said that they called. Then he had called for a light and sprang it and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas. That brought me to my promise that he told me I'd make the enemies your footstool.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. At some point, our working would have to bow down to you.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. He said, then he called for a light and sprang it and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas. And brought them out and said, sir, what must I do to be saved?
Yes.
There will be some people in your life that have been bought with a price to keep you shackled and bound and everything. But the Lord is going to fix it with prayer, through prayer and supplication.
Yes.
Hallelujah. They're going to have to come before you. But you have to have the heart that Paul had.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Paul told him more about Jesus. Not only did Paul tell him about Jesus, he received Jesus Christ. Not only did he get saved, his whole household got saved. In other words, church, I'm trying to tell you, if you found yourself locked in a prison, you feel like you're bound and shackled. Hallelujah. It is not for you. It's for the ones that who think they're keeping you bound and shackled. It's for you to minister to them. It's for you to tell them about Jesus. It's for them to get delivered. Use your anointing. Use your keys. Hallelujah. Prayer is the key. Faith unlocks the door. When I think about prayer, and I think about in this passage how Paul went through this ordeal, and Lydia got saved. Then the demon got the woman got delivered of the demon, and then the jailer and his family got delivered. How many of us are willing to sacrifice to go through the things Paul went through in order for these three individuals to get delivered? The problem with the church today is that we want to pray about things for us. But when it comes to sacrificing for other people, interceding for other people, we're just not willing. But I know what the Spirit of the Lord is telling me today. He says that there's an army rising up. He said everybody ain't going to be in my army. Some of us are not girded with the right equipment. You have to put on the whole armor of God. You have to be able to take the darts of the enemy. You have to be able to block for somebody. You have to be able to go and pray for somebody. Sometimes when you study the word, it is not for you. It's for the people that you're going to have to help. You have to be able to be a sacrifice, a living testimony, holy and acceptable to God, willing to forfeit your life, lay down your life for what God has called you to do. Pray in intercession. Pray in intercession. Pray in
Lord Jesus. Bless our Lord Jesus. Be glorified.